The Radio Memories Network is brought to you in part by Liberated Syndication, podcast publishing made easy, libsyn.com. That's libsyn.com.
Welcome to Sci-Fi. From its earliest time, radio has always been interested in science fiction. Characters leap into your living room as we go on an adventure into time and space. We now go back to the early days of science fiction on the radio and our imaginations with our featured sci-fi presentation.
Open Secrets by Alice Munro. Dramatized for radio by Claire Luckham. Spaceships Have Landed, with Barbara Barnes, William Hope, and Adam Henderson.
Uni! Uni!
What was I doing the night she disappeared? I don't remember. I remember the next day. Wait a minute. Yes, I do. Monks. In the bootleggers. Monks.
Uni Morgan, where are you?
Uni Morgan disappeared in 1953. My daughter used to play with her when they were little. The Morgans lived down by the river. They grew vegetables and raspberries and rhubarb that they sold in town.
I was out with Billy Dowd the night Uni went missing.
That was the night I took Rhea in the Monks. It was a thing for Rhea and myself to team up with Wayne and Lucille at the dance in Wally Pavilion. Then afterwards we'd end up in Monks, Wayne and myself, that is. We left the girls keeping each other company in one of the cars.
Around midnight, the night Uni disappeared, I heard the screen door close when she went out. I heard it and thought nothing of it. I thought she'd gone to the toilet. We have no indoor plumbing. Our toilet is at the back, down a dirt path, in a clump of red currants and lilacs. None of us go that far at night. Uni and I squat on the grass, and he waters the spirea at the far end of the porch. I must have gone back to sleep, because I woke later on, and then I thought, I never heard her come back in. So I got up and I walked around the house to look for her.
Twenty past 2.
I went back upstairs and shook him till he woke up. Wake up. Wake up.
What? What do you want?
Uni's not down there.
Where is she, then?
Well, she's not up to me to know. Wake up! Wake up! Get up. We gotta find her. Put your trousers on. And your boots. Now, where's your flashlight?
What do I need my flashlight for?
Take to the toilet. Shine it!
I am!
Go on!
Huh?
Inside! We've got to look inside! In the corners!
Why would she be in the corner? She couldn't fit in a corner!
In the lilacs, then!
No!
We poked the light inside the building and found nothing. Then we peered among the sturdy lilac trunks and along the path that led through a sagging section of the wire fence to the wild growth along the riverbank.
She wouldn't be in the river.
Nothing there.
Nobody.
Back at the house, I spotted something glinting in the corner like knives or a man in armor.
There, shine it there.
Well, yeah, it's a bicycle.
Uni!
I called her at the back of the house and at the front. We've got plum trees at the front. There's no sidewalk, just a dirt path between them. The trunks crowded in like watchers, crooked black animals.
Uni!
was as if it was sat in those branches.
Half a mile further up, the road that passes Monk's and then the Morgans ends up in a field too marshy for any use. Weedy poplars grow up through willow bushes and elderberries. In the other direction, it meets the road from the town, then crosses the river and climbs the hill to my chicken farm. On the river flats lie the old fairgrounds, some grandstands abandoned since before the war, when the fair was taken over by the big fair at Wally. You can still see the racetrack oval marked out in the grass. That's where the town set out to be 100 years ago, before the river flooding persuaded people to move to higher ground, leaving only the one row of houses.
Yoni! Yoni!
We gave up, sat down in the kitchen without any light on. What's the time?
Between 3 and 4. What do we do?
Wait. You said wait.
Wait till she gets back? What else can we do?
Wayne's girlfriend, Lucille, had stayed home with a cold, so Rhea and I had gone along to the dance by ourselves. And I was driving her back when I spotted Wayne's car outside Monk's.
Wayne's car. Ho, 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 Wayne the boy.
Wayne is the United Church minister's son from Bondi, a village not far from Carstairs. He was at college with me. He's going to be a journalist. He's already got a job on a newspaper in Calgary.
Wayne the boy. Beat us to it.
In we go. In we go, you two.
Me?
Yes. I can't see Wayne when we go in, and Mrs. Monk looks after Rhea. I pull out a chair and sit down to watch the card game at the table, waiting for a game.
My petticoat crackles when I sit. Embarrassing. You have to wear one to make your skirt stand out, like crackling straw. Funny how you remember things. I'm embarrassed and I laugh to hide it and to say sorry to someone, but Mrs. Monk doesn't notice. She's already gone to get me a Coca-Cola. Wayne comes in from somewhere, and I catch his eye. He raises his eyebrows in a way that's comradely but incriminating. He won't have heard the crackling.
I'm surprised to see Rhea when I get back from phoning Lucille. You don't see women in Monk's. It's not a disgraceful place, but it leaves a slight stain. He goes to Monk's, as if it explains something.
So this is Monk's. There are flood stains on the wallpaper. Otherwise, everything is tidy, barren almost. Dark green blinds pulled down, and a tin curtain in one corner, probably concealing an old dumb waiter.
Wayne and I don't do our usual greeting with a growl and a punch in the air. Too many older men watching.
I know some of the men, at least by sight. Dint Mason, who shovels snow off the school sidewalks through the winter. That man who was a teacher but now sells pots and pans for waterless cookery. I don't know his name. I know he is a diabetic. They say his condition is so severe that he always has a drop of pure sugar crystallized at the end of his penis. One or two others, Mr. Monk and Wayne.
I find I keep looking at Rhea.
I wish I knew if he liked me or not.
He was just about to take
Watch your language.
He says that because I'm here.
A call of nature. Out on the rocks to answer a call of nature.
Okay.
And he was thinking he'd like a piece of something to come in handy.
A piece of what?
He sees this stuff lying around. Uh-huh. If that isn't the very thing laying all over in sheets. So he picks it up and stuffs it in his pockets and thinks, plenty for the next time. Doesn't think any more about it and goes back to camp.
Wayne looks at me and then looks away again. He doesn't smile.
So, somebody sees what he's got.
What is it?
Well, what's up there? Yeah. Well, he says, I don't know. Where'd you pick it up? It was just laying around. Well, what do you think it is? Well, I don't know.
Mrs. Monk is the most interesting person in the room. Her legs are bare, but she is wearing high heels. You can hear them tapping all the time on the floorboards. There are rumors about Mrs. Monk. I've heard about other demands that men make, other signals that a man might give. They say Mrs. Monk lays aside her apron and proceeds out of the room into the front hall. I suppose there's a staircase out there leading to the bedrooms. The other men pretend not to notice, and she climbs the stairs without looking back, and the man following her follows with his eyes her neat buttocks in her schoolteacher's skirt. Then she arranges herself on a waiting bed without the least bit of hesitation or enthusiasm. Such indifferent readiness, such cool accommodation, makes the idea of such a quick and driven, bought and paid for encounter exciting. Shamefully exciting.
Sounds a lot like asbestos.
Well, yes, yeah, asbestos. And on the spot, they developed the biggest asbestos mine in the entire world. And from that mine came a fortune.
Is that where Wayne's been?
Some have found gold and got the good of it. Sir Harry Oakes, for instance, he found it. He got to be a millionaire.
Is that what he's been doing?
He got himself killed.
Millionaires, billionaires, what comes after billionaires?
Up there with her?
What's Rhea making of all this?
I never said he didn't get killed. I said he found it. He got the good of it. He got to be a millionaire.
I catch his eye. He smiles.
No! Oh,
Hey, next time.
Not so many brains in this room as there is arsehole.
Uni's the one that always knows what to do.
Do you remember?
What?
When she came.
Thought I was having the change. Then there was all this commotion in my stomach.
You said indigestion.
Well, we'd gone on for so long without anything happening.
One day in the post office, you had to ask for a chair. You were feeling weak.
Cramps. I had cramps.
Your waters burst.
I was on the chair and I was wet. I began to be in pain.
Hey, got you into hospital.
Uni popped out. Her hair was all white.
Yeah, even when she was born, she made us sit up, pay attention.
Where is she?
Go on, then. Get rid of some bad rubbish. Snake, back to where you came from.
One summer, Rhea spent all her time with Uni. They were 10. Rhea went down there. It was never the other way around. Rhea's mother complained she came back covered in mud. But that's as much as I remember.
We weren't friends. We were Toms, and play is the wrong word. We were at war, battling continuously with the Banershees.
Get rid of snakes!
The Toms built a city of mud on the riverbank, walled with stones against the Banershee's attack, and contained.
They've got a queen. I know that. A new queen. A new queen! They've got a new queen, stupid.
A new leader appeared. A Banershee queen. Her name was Joylinda, and her schemes were diabolical.
And I'm not stupid. I know what she's called. What then? Joylinda!
We were never friends in the way I came to understand being friends later on. We never tried to please or comfort each other. We did not share secrets, except for the game. So maybe that was what we shared. The nature, the danger of being Toms.
Joylinda's poisoned the blackberries!
Help! We're poisoned! Poisoned! We'll die!
I envied Uni some things. For instance, She always seemed to rule her own life.
After that one summer, Rhea didn't see much of Uni. They went to the same school on the same road, but Rhea had her bicycle by that time, and Uni walked.
Uni! Hi-ho, Silver!
I never got off my bike so that we could walk together.
Remember when Uni was 15? Came home from school, said she'd left and gone and got a job?
He told us. I'm not going anymore. I'm going to the glove factory.
She's got her own money now. And her bike. And her radio.
Yes. Tells us things she's heard. News of crimes and accidents. Hurricanes, avalanches, floods. We haven't the time to listen.
Well, that's what I meant. Is that it? Why she's gone?
After grade 9, when I stopped riding my bike to school, Uni would ride hers to work. She didn't ride past. She stopped and walked alongside me, as if she was doing me a favor.
Hi-ho!
It's not a favor at all. She'd always looked peculiar. But now... She's 5'9" or 10", drab and mannish in slacks and bandanas, big feet and shoes that must be men's. A heavy, hectoring voice, a clumsy, ungainly walk. People laugh.
Aren't you tired of going to school?
And she asks me all these personal questions.
Is your bike broken? Can't your father afford to get it fixed? What has happened to your hair?
But worse, much worse than the intimate questionings, are her stories of murders, disasters, freakish events. Then I have to ask her questions.
Is that on the news, Uni? Was it a story? Were there people acting in front of a microphone, or was it reporting? Uni, was it read or was it a play? Tell me.
I never know if the things she's telling me about are real or not. I don't know if she knows... I don't know if she knows the difference. She gets on her bicycle and rides away.
Tell me. Toodaloo, see you in the zoo. Tell me, Uni.
Leaving me frazzled and confused. Uni's job suited her. She worked in the glove factory, situated on the second and third floor of a building in the main street. There is something the same between people close to the bottom, like Uni Morgan, and people close to the top, like Billy Dowd. They show the same blunted understanding and carelessness towards other people. I got a job, too, during my last year at high school, in a shoe store on Saturday afternoons.
When I'd finished college, I went home to learn to run the piano factory. That's when I saw Rhea in the shop. I went in to buy a pair of boots so that I could get to meet her.
Good. I'll take my shoes off then, shall I?
Oh.
What?
Your socks.
What's wrong with them?
They're too fine for boots. You should wear woolen socks. These will slip around.
Do you sell woolen ones?
He asks me to put the socks on for him. His feet are long and white and perfectly sweet-smelling. A lovely soap... with a whiff of talcum. He leans back in the chair, tall and pale, cool and clean. He might have been carved from soap.
That's sweet of you. I asked her to the opening dance of the season at the Wally Pavilion. After that, we went to the dance in Wally every Saturday night.
There goes your heartthrob, girls would say at school. I felt the glow of a prize winner, rather a prize, about me. I woke in the mornings with the sense that I'd been given a present, but I couldn't remember what it was. My mind had boxed it away overnight.
Hold me, never let me go until you turn.
We would leave the dance with Wayne and Lucille around midnight and drive in two cars to the parking spot at the end of a dirt road on the bluffs above Lake Huron. Billy puts an arm round my shoulders, and sometimes he squeezes me, or he nuzzles my cheek or drops a row of kisses on my hair. Then he taps his fingers on me, on my knees, and just at the top of my breasts. He murmurs appreciatively, and then scolds himself, or scolds me, and tells me that he has to keep the lid on me.
Oh, you're quite the baddie.
Then his voice goes deep, deep, not like him, like a sleek and languishing movie actor, and he'll slip his hand between my legs, touch the skin above my stockings, and then jump and laugh.
Ooh, hot, too hot there. Wonder how old Wayne's getting on.
After a time, either Billy or Wayne sound a blast on the horn. Then the other one has to answer. This game or contest, I don't understand what's going on, comes eventually to take up more and more of his attention.
What do you think? What do you think? Should I give the boy the horn?
On the drive back to Carstairs, to Monk's, I feel like crying, for no reason, and my arms and legs feel like they've had cement poured into them. Left alone, I would probably have fallen asleep, but I can't because Lucille's afraid of the dark. And when Billy and Wayne go into Monk's, I have to keep Lucille company.
Won't be long.
Lucille is a thin, fair-haired girl with a finicky stomach, irregular periods, and sensitive skin. The vagaries of her body fascinate her, and she treats it as if it is a troublesome but valuable pet.
Wayne's engaged to Lucille. He's stuck to her all this time, and he says he's going to marry her because she'll make a good wife. You can see his point. Wayne says she's not the prettiest girl in the world, and she's certainly not the smartest. But because of this, he'll always feel secure in the marriage. Some people might say that was taking a cynical approach, but others might say realistic. And a minister's son does have to be realistic. He's got to make his own way in life. Anyway, Wayne is Wayne. Wayne is Wayne.
So how about you? Are you getting used to it?
Oh, yes.
They say it's better without gloves on. I guess I'll find out once I'm married.
Oh, she means... Oh!
Once I'm married, I'll be using sponges and jellies.
Sounds like dessert. Oh, don't laugh. She'll be insulted. Oh, my God, that's what she means.
I am so tired with this conflict that's raging around my wedding. Honestly, I plan for the bridesmaids to wear wreaths of rosebuds. I want rosebuds. And I thought it was all settled, and then Wayne's sister gets a permanent that turns out badly. Honestly. And now she wants to wear a hat to cover it up. It's not as if she's a friend, even. She's only in the wedding because of being his sister, so I couldn't leave her out. Honestly, she's a selfish person. Believe me, I've come out in hives because of her.
And all I can think of is how lucky I am Billy Dowd has chosen me.
Billy playing cards. Rhea in her green dress, rocking. Me watching Rhea, usually while Billy is talking, noticing he isn't paying her attention. Eventually, I sign to her. Does she want another drink?
Sit down before I fall down.
Thanks. There's something else besides Coca-Cola in this. I won't drink all, or even half. I'll take a little drink now and then to show Wayne he hasn't flummoxed me.
Is that all right? Is that the kind of drink you like?
It's fine. I like all kinds of drinks.
All kinds? That's good. You sound like the right kind of girl for Billy Dowd.
Does he drink a lot, Billy?
Put it this way. Is the Pope Jewish? No, wait. Is Jesus Catholic? No. Continue. I would not want to give you the wrong impression. Is Billy a drunk? Is he an alcoholic? Is he an arsehole? I mean, an arseholic. No, I got that wrong, too. Forgot who I was talking to.
Excuse, please. Eliminate. Sorry.
I've never heard him say so much. In such strange voices. Billy usually talks.
You must not come to the conclusion that I don't like Billy. No, no, I would never want you to think that.
But you don't like him.
Don't I? Do I not? How could that be? I mean, Billy is such a lovely person. Look at him over there, drinking and playing cards with the common people.
I look at the back of Billy's white shirt. He hasn't even turned round once to look at me.
Don't you find him nice? Or do you ever think it is a little strange that anybody can be so nice all the time? All the time. There is only one time I've known him slip up, and that's when I got him talking about some of his old girlfriends. Don't tell me you haven't noticed that. He does rake those poor girls over the coals. The hairy legs, the halitosis. Doesn't it ever make you nervous? I mean, but then, you're so nice and clean. I bet you shave your legs every night.
Wayne runs his hand down my leg. I thank my lucky stars I'd shave before going to the dance.
Or do you put that stuff on him? It melts the hair away. What is that stuff called?
Neat.
Neat. That's the stuff. Only doesn't it have kind of a bad smell? A little moldy or like yeast or something? Yeast. Isn't that another thing girls get? Am I embarrassing you? I should be a gentleman and get you another drink. If I can stand and walk, I'll get you another drink. Oh, this has hardly got any whiskey in it. This won't hurt you.
That probably isn't true, the first statement about the whiskey. But the second is certainly true. Nothing can hurt me. Nothing is lost on me. I don't think Wayne has any good intentions, but I'm enjoying myself. And all the bafflement, the fogged-in feeling I had when I was with Billy, has burned away. I feel like laughing at everything that Wayne says, or that I myself say. I feel safe.
This is a funny house.
How is it funny?
Oh.
That just, how is this house funny? You're the one that's funny.
He reminds me of some kind of dog.
What is funny is the tin curtain in the corner of the room. I think there's a dumb waiter behind it that goes up and down from the cellar.
Hey, we could curl up on the shelf. Want to try it? We could get Billy to let down the rope.
He's sitting directly in front of me, which is good, because if he does turn round, he won't be able to see Wayne flicking his fingers against the sole of my foot, my shoe hanging off.
I'll have to go to the bathroom first.
I'll escort you.
He has to grab my legs to pull himself up.
You're drunk.
Oh, yeah, I'm not the only one.
Good. Let him. Just let him. I turned off the light and stepped into the dark hall. Hands took charge of me at once. I was guided and propelled out of the back door. Up against the wall of the house, me and Wayne pushing and grabbing and kissing each other. I feel I'm being opened and squeezed shut, like an accordion. I was getting a warning, too. Something in the distance not connected with what we were doing. Some crowding and snorting inside or outside of me, trying to make itself understood.
Hey, get down, Rory! Get down! Down!
Shh! The warning comes from my stomach. The back door opens. Wayne says something clearly into my ear. I never know what happened first.
As I let her go, she begins to be sick.
When I finished, I'm shivering and my dance dress is wet. Someone else, not Wayne, pulls me up and wipes my face with the hem of my dress. Mrs. Monk. She tells me to keep my mouth closed and breathe through my nose. She tells Wayne and or the dog to get out of there. She says she'll tell Billy I got tired and takes me home.
Rhea, I'm leaving. If you find time heavy, you can clean the eggs on the table. Drink lots and lots of water.
I want to scream at them all to get out of the house. I have things to consider. Things inside my head that can't get free because of the pressure of people in the house. That's why I have a headache. I get out of bed carefully and go carefully downstairs. Take 3 aspirins, drink as much water as I can, measure coffee into the pot without looking down. The eggs are on the table in 6-quart baskets, smears of hen manure and bits of straw sticking to them, waiting to be rubbed off with steel wool. But I have things to think of. What things? Words. The words Wayne used before Mrs. Monk came.
I'd like to screw you if you weren't so ugly.
Except he didn't use the word screw. I'm not ugly. I know I'm not ugly. How can you ever be sure that you're not ugly? If I'd been ugly, would Billy Dowd have ever gone out with me in the first place? Billy, who prides himself on being kind... No. Wayne was very drunk. Drunkards speak truth. I'm glad I'm not seeing Mother today. If she ever found out, and she would, she'd worm it out of me. She'd want Wayne told off, spoken to. She'd phone his father, the minister. The word he used would make her angry, more angry than saying I was ugly. She'd miss the point entirely. Father's reaction would be more complicated. First, he'd blame Billy for taking me to a place like Monk's. He'd be angry about the word part, too, but he would be ashamed of me, forever ashamed that a man had called me ugly. You can't let your parents anywhere near your real humiliations. I know I'm not ugly, but how can I know I'm not ugly? Wayne used his real voice when he said it. Over there are flashes of river and part of the old fairgrounds. You can see where the old racetrack used to go round. There's someone down there. Walking, following the racetrack. It's Uni. Uni Morgan. Is she wearing her pajamas? Walking along the racetrack in light-colored, maybe pale pink pajamas. It's 9:30 in the morning. She's gone off now, down the path to where the riverbank path used to be, behind the bushes. Her white hair is all sticking up, catching the light, same as the pajamas. She looks like an angel in feathers. Weird, but not weird. When we were children, I used to think her hair looked like a snowball or like threads of ice preserved from winter. On a hot summer's day, I'd want to mash my face in it to get cool.
Hello?
I want to ask you something, and not on the phone. Dad and the boys have gone to Hamilton.
Okay.
Rhea is on the front porch cleaning eggs.
I want to know what you meant.
By what?
She just looks at me, keeps looking. She has an egg in one hand and a bit of steel wool in the other. I want to go past her, inside, out of the sun. I know what she means.
I was drunk. You're not ugly.
I know I'm not.
I feel awful.
Not for that.
Well, I was drunk. It was a joke.
You don't want to get married to her. Lucille.
I hear her. I want the railing to support me, her to stop. Maybe I'm going to be sick. I get over it and try my raising of the eyebrow, my discouraging smile.
Oh, really? No kidding. So what advice do you have for me?
Write a note. Get in your car and drive to Calgary.
Just like that?
If you want, I'll ride with you to Toronto. You can drop me off and I'll stay at the Y until I get a job. This is what I mean to do. I swear it is what I mean to do. I feel more at liberty now and more dazzled by myself than I was when I was drunk. It seems so easy.
Did you ever look at a map? You don't go through Toronto on your way to Calgary. You go across the border at Sarnia and up through the States to Winnipeg and then to Calgary.
Drop me off in Winnipeg then. That's better.
One question. Have you had a sanity test recently?
No.
She won't smile. She won't.
Light. Day.
Yes.
You're not back.
No.
Before, when I worked for Dowd's in the factory, they always used to send for Mr. Dowd in an emergency.
He's dead. What if you get hurt?
Someone must know what to do.
She's got a short fuse.
I'll phone anyway.
The river path isn't clear. That's surprising. I thought it would be clear. Brambles have grown all over it. Scratches. All these scratches on my arms. Blood on my hand. From my forehead. Bits of leaves in my hair.
Joy Linda! Joy Linda?
Joy Linda!
Joy Linda! Joy Linda!
The kitchen is full of people. Aunt Muriel, the police chief, Billy Dowd, all in our kitchen. Why don't they say anything?
Your face is all dirty down one side.
Now, where have you been?
Up on the old fairground.
Why?
Why?
Yes.
Joy Linda's poisoned the blackberries!
Help!
Last night, I was in the yard and three children came up to me. They said they had something to show me. Well, I asked them what they were doing up so late at night. What was the answer? I don't remember. They carried me along. That's what happened. I never said I'd go, but they took me. Through the gap in the fence at the corner of the yard and along the path on the riverbank. There were no brambles. I was surprised. I hadn't been that way for years.
Help!
Two boys and a girl. They must have been 9 or 10 or 11. They were wearing a kind of seersucker sunsuit with a bib on the front and straps over the shoulders, all fresh and clean. They were perfectly clean, polite, ordinary children.
You could see them.
They must have had some kind of light around them, I think. They took me down the path and onto the fairground to their tent. I don't remember that on the outside. I was suddenly inside it. White, very high and white and shivering, like the sails from a boat, only lit up. I don't know where the light came from. I was walking in bare feet on something cool and smooth, not grass. I was sat down on a seat and the children began to weave a spell around me. It was like mosquito netting or some such stuff, light but strong.
But she's wonderful.
They didn't stop moving, winding and weaving round me, never bumping into each other. I couldn't ask any more questions. There was some sort of singing or humming that seemed to get inside my head and stop me. If you asked about anything, it would have been like asking what a teapot was doing in the kitchen.
Absolutely wonderful.
I don't know what happened next. I don't remember. When I woke up, there was nothing round me or over me, just hot sunlight. I was lying in the fairgrounds on hard earth.
Later, the newspapers printed a drawing, an artist's impression. Something that looked like a sailboat and a saucer. Uni didn't call it a flying saucer, not when she described it. Nor did she say anything about the capture and investigation of her body, the sampling of her blood and fluids, the possibility that one of her secret eggs could have been spirited away and fertilization taken place in an alien dimension. Well, that all came out in a book later. I kept thinking, what a relief, what a blessing to find in the world, and so close at hand, someone like her. A calm, preposterous creature. I made up my mind to look after her then and there, whatever lay ahead. Later, I found out about Rhea and Wayne running away, and almost I blessed them. It didn't matter.
Uni had her taste of fame. Reporters, someone who was writing a book, photographers, they all came. She didn't make a penny out of it. Wayne and Rhea got married in Calgary. Rhea wrote they had to be married to get an apartment, and they didn't want to live apart. That's the way they've continued to feel most of the time. They discuss living separately and threaten it, and they've given it a couple of brief tries, but... Wayne left journalism for television. I used to see him on the late news, delivering pieces of information. Later, he traveled, and there were reports from abroad. And still later, he got to be one of those people who sit indoors and discuss what the news means and who is telling lies.
We look up Billy and Uni, who are friends of ours in a way. We drive out to where the old fairground used to be. The river houses have all gone. Everything from the first mistaken settlement. The land is now a floodplain.
I can't get used to it.
Time marches on.
Soon after Billy's mother died, the problems at Dowd's multiplied. While she'd been alive, it had been run as efficiently as she'd run the library. Billy had to sell out, and eventually the factory was closed. No more pianos were made in Carstairs. He got a job in Toronto. Something to do with schizophrenics or drug addicts or Christianity. And he hired Uni to look after his sister B when she began drinking too much to look after herself.
I give up drinking myself. And when B dies, I inherit the house and come back to Carstairs to turn it into a home for old people. And I ask Uni to marry me.
I wouldn't want for there to be anything going on or anything, Billy Dowd.
Oh, my dear. My dear Uni.
In Open Secrets, Spaceships Have Landed by Alice Munro, dramatized for radio by Claire Luckham, Rhea was played by Barbara Barnes. Billy Dowd was William Hope, Wayne, Adam Henderson, and Uni, Tony Barry. Mrs. Morgan was Susan Engel, Mr. Morgan, Stuart Milligan, and Mr. Sellers, Garrick Hagen. Lucille was Karina Dainty, and Mr. Monk, Sam Mancuso. Other parts were played by members of the cast. The director was Marion Nancarrow.